Hello, everyone, and welcome to Dr. Emmett Emery Sr., You Better Stand Your Watch Leader and Leadership Podcast. I want to thank you for coming out, tuning in, or standing up watching, whatever you're doing. But thank you for tuning in to this podcast. I got a reoccurring guest today, which is Trez. I keep beating her name up. She's so nice. She's not saying anything bad to me. Ibrahim. I might have got the last name right this time, but first name wrong. Today, we're going to talk about women leaders and mental health in the workplace. Before Trez introduces herself again to my audience, because it's been a while since she's been on, I just want to stress, we are coming from a leader and leadership perspective. That means that I'm not licensed, nor she's licensed in the mental health field. But we have experience in dealing with individuals from a leadership and leader perspective with mental health. From our experience is what we're going to talk about. How do we intervene? How do we help individuals? And we already know that without saying that you recommend them for help through psychiatry or whatever, medication, whatever. So we're just basically touching underneath the surface, not the surface, underneath the surface about mental health in the workplace. Because I experienced a lot, and tell you, and I dealt with it a lot. And it's been more prevalent since COVID on versus prior to. All right, Trez, introduce yourself to my audience.
Hi, thank you so much for having me here and having me again. It was we had a great conversation the last time, so I appreciate the invitation back. My name is Trez Ibrahim, and I am a success and spiritual coach. I am an evolutionary strategist, speaker, author, trainer, and I've been working with business owners, executives, and entrepreneurs for over 35 years. And yes, I started when I was 2. I insist on that. Helping them reach massive levels of success, to set a goal and reach towards it and break through any barriers that they have to access possibilities. And I've worked in every industry, every age group. And so I'm very blessed to have worked with some amazing people. And I've been around the block a couple of times.
Okay. First, I'm going to start you off with the definition of mental health in the workplace, and you'll see exactly what areas we're going to cover with this topic today. Mental health in the workplace refers to employees' emotional, psychological, and social well-being within a shared work environment. Employees with sound mental health who have respect for themselves and their employees/employer build positive workplace relationships and cope with the daily challenges and responsibility in the workplace. Juggling multiple roles and responsibilities, including professional duties and workplace commitments, household chores, and caregiving obligations, can create a significant mental health burden for women. Remember, this topic is mental health involving women, not men. Man, you'll get your chance some other time. The pressure to meet deadlines, excel in their careers, and maintain work-life balance can lead to heightened stress levels. High workload and household duties affect mental health for women in the workplace in the following area. Research shows that 1 in 5 working women suffer from workplace anxiety, depression, and burnout. Studies claim that 1 in 7 young women ages 16 to 24 years of age have PTSD, such as eating disorders and sleep disorders. We don't even look at that as PTSD. As a disabled veteran myself with PTSD, I understand there's various areas of PTSD. And outside the military, civilians doesn't understand what PTSD is or the impact it has upon them. The incidence of self-injury are higher in women with disabilities of color or those belonging to the LGBTQIA+ community. Emotionally, stress can lead to symptoms of anxiety and depression, affecting concentration, decision-making abilities, and overall job performance. These are 3 great impacts in a job workforce community. Building a positive, inclusive workforce culture that promotes work-life balance and encourage open communication is crucial. Working women can also incorporate strategies into their daily lives to mitigate stress. Effective time management techniques, such as prioritizing tasks and setting realistic goals, help create a sense of control, reduce stress levels, and maintain sound mental health for women. We might overlap in some of the things that we say involving mental health. Then I just want you to focus on the viewpoint that we're using, not so much of what we're saying. Mental health and COVID in the workplace. The independent source for healthy policy research, polling, and news stated that One in 10 women report quitting a job due to a pandemic-related reason. And almost half said that one of the reasons was because they felt unsafe at their workplace. School closures had a substantial effect on working mothers' ability to fulfill work obligations. One in 10 working mothers with children under 18 said they quit a job due to COVID. And half of this job cited school closures as one of the reasons. 3 out of 10 working mothers said they had to take time off because schools or daycare was closed. In addition to juggling new increased home and work responsibility, many women went without pay due to school closures. Almost half, 47%, of working mothers said they took unpaid sick leave because their children's school or daycare closed. This rose to 65% among low-income mothers, African-American, Hispanics, and 7% among those working part-time jobs. Family caregiving responsibility before and after pandemic have largely fallen on the women's responsibility, not the men's and not the kids, on the women. I remember joking with my son. I told him, I said, you got to remember, in America, the father loves the son and protect the daughter. I said, I love you enough to give you my name. He said, wow, that means a lot. I said, I want you to love me enough to give your son your name, and then love his son enough to get a name so we keep it going. I said, but I protect my daughter because she's my investment. I said, because she's going to be the one to take care of me when I get sick. Your butt ain't going to be around. Family caregiving responsibility before and after the pandemic has largely fallen on women. More than 1 in 10 women reported by they were caring for a family member who needed special assistance prior to the pandemic. Over 1 in 10 women reported that they have new caregiving responsibility as a result of the pandemic. 1 in 10. Over half of mothers with school-aged children said that the stress and worry of the pandemic has affected their mental health. 1 in 5 characterizing the impact as major. Men, husbands, sons, brothers, listen to these women. We know they can carry heavy burdens. We know when they're in pain, they don't say too much. They still carry on with the duties and work and things of that nature. So we overlook the fact that they're in pain, but they still talk. So we have to listen. Even though they look like they normally function, but they say they're not. If they looking for help, a woman is more prideful than a man. She won't ask for it. She'll tell her girlfriends that and then tell her don't say nothing. However, only 16% of mothers have sought mental health. Only 16% mental health care. Given that the mental health effects are likely to persist for a long time, access to mental health care would be an important issue to watch, particularly for mothers. I'm curious to hear Trish's viewpoint on how her area of leadership and leader expertise, training and development, intertwine with the mental health and COVID.
Oh, wow. Big question. And absolutely. I mean, mental health is at the forefront of a woman's well-being. I mean, she has to be able to get herself out of bed to accomplish things, to take care of the family, take care of a number of responsibilities. And, you know, I think the biggest thing about mental health is it's really one's ability to be resilient and it's developing coping abilities. And so when a situation happens, it's what can you do? How do you take your power back? And what resources are available to you, internal resources and external resources? And so, you know, COVID was a situation and we all had to change what we were doing and how we were doing it. And some of us did it elegantly and others struggled through it. And it was really a matter of looking at number one, I'm a big proponent in looking at, again, all of your resources. How can you step up and get, number one, know what you need and then get what you need. And so
good point. And so
number one, if I became a victim, and I've been a victim, you know, we've all like kind of, you know, sat down, curled up and said, I'm a victim because it feels good in the moment, but we know long-term it never works. And so
You're right, Swiss. Cause I told my wife I was a victim, so yeah, whatever. And it didn't work.
At some point you got to get up and take care of stuff, right?
Exactly.
You know, Jim Rohn, one of my teachers said, you know, don't wish life was easier. Wish you were better.
I'll use that one.
Absolutely. And so situations happened. COVID happened. And really, how do we step out of victimhood and look at, okay, the world changed. dynamics change, structures change. What do I need to do now to get what I want? And a lot of people had to make some big decisions. And, a lot of them had some great decisions they made. They pivoted their business. They started businesses. They got to spend more time at home with their children. They got to spend more time with their family and doing the things that that matter. It gave them an excuse to leave a toxic environment. And others kept fighting, this shouldn't happen. This shouldn't happen. I'm a victim. This is horrible. And curled up in a ball and didn't weren't able to build those resilient muscles. They didn't cope very well with it. And so in my work with my clients, I really help them to develop that inner strength and look at what's available to them so that they could break through whatever is in front of them, because that just makes them bigger, better, more successful. And then they could accomplish the next challenge or achieve the next achievement. And so mental health has to be at the forefront of everyone's mind. They have to build that inner resilience, that inner ability to cope, looking at what is, how do they deal with stress, and are they turning to stress? For to me, my definition, and again, I'm not a mental health professional, as you reminded us, the definition of stress for me is the body without the resources to overcome a situation. It doesn't have the information that it needs to handle something in front of them. So if something's happening to me, I don't know what to do, or I don't have the resources, or I don't have the experience, or I don't have the money, whatever thing I need to deal with that, it causes stress in me. Now I can do two things with the stress. I can say, oh, I'm stressed and curled into a ball, or I can realize, oh, my body's in stress, my mind is in stress because I've never been in this situation before, or I've never broken through this barrier before. Okay, let's figure it out. And that's where that power comes. That's when that resilience comes. That's when now I become stronger for the next challenge. So COVID gave us an extreme, great opportunity to pivot and change and to really look at ourselves. And it broke down a lot of things that weren't working in the workforce, in our interactions. We saw a lot of families fall apart because people realized they were in a loveless marriage, or there were problems in their marriage that they could easily ignore because they were running off to work every day. And when they were stuck at home with someone, they just realized, this isn't what I want. So we have to be working on ourselves. We have to be working on ourselves. And that does involve getting a mental health professional. That does involve learning self-care techniques. That does involve learning how to meditate or deal with whatever issues are coming up for me. That does involve learning new strategies. Again, prioritizing myself and being a better fill in the blank, better communicator, better organizer, better time manager, whatever it is. And so we have to prioritize it. And I believe we have to find, there's a lot of resources out there, and not everyone has access to it. And so we have to make that more available, or take the steps to really, not or, and take the steps to find those resources.
It's very interesting you mentioned types of method. One method that I use to relax stress, because you don't destroy it, it's just dormant until something happens to bring it back up again. So one method I used to soothe was listen to jazz. It soothes me. And where did I get that from? I get that from the biblical form, when David used music to relax Saul, when Saul was going through the headaches and the migraines and the things of that nature, and he needed to relax, and David used the music to relax him. So I said, okay, let me try some music. So first I tried heavy metal. Oh my God, that did not work. So I said, let me use some soothing music. And I used the jazz and it relaxed me. What method did you use?
Well, I'll tell you, I love what you said, and I'll share with you what I use. And really, when you look at stress and when you look at a situation's come up, and I don't have the information to deal with the stress. And so what happens to our physical body? First of all, my heart rate increases, right? I'm stressed, I'm anxious, I'm worried, I'm scared, I'm, whatever emotions are coming up because I don't know what to do. When my heart rate increases, my brainwave patterns change. I go into what's called high beta. Now, when my brain is in high beta, because my heart's increased. I don't, and what that, the reason that happens is because it's pushing my body to react, run, fight, or freeze, right? That's what curl in a ball. And so in high beta, that's not the time to make a decision. At that point, any decision I make is going to probably be the incorrect one. I'm going to say things I shouldn't say or that I'll regret later. I am going to get more angry. I'm going to create more conflict. I'm going to lose my problem-solving abilities. I'm going to lose access to the wisdom within me. Because when I'm running, that's not a time to think about, oh, what should I do when this tiger is chasing me? Should I, you know, like I'm not thinking,
yes,
right?
Yes.
I'm running. And so in high beta, you can't think. You don't have access to solutions. So how do we decrease into low beta and lower our heart rate? By, like you said, listening to soothing music. That music brings your heart rate down. For me, it's getting into that quiet meditative space. For everyone, all it is a matter of taking a deep breath. Studies have shown that if I take a long, slow, deep inhale and slow exhale, my heart rate starts to decrease. My brain waves go back to low beta. You know, children learn this, right? It's take a, you know, we tell them, breathe, breathe. When we take
you also fall asleep in this method because the producer's falling asleep now as he's listening to you.
Well, it's relaxing, right? It's relaxing. And as I relax my body, my brain waves slow down. When my brain waves slow down, which, you know, yeah, it's soothing, then I have more access to solutions. I have more access to answers. I can handle problems. I open up to possibility. I listen better. I'm able to resolve conflicts better. I'm able to communicate in a better way. I'm able to inspire people around me to support me. So it's not a nice to have, you know, we talk about mental health. It's not a nice to have, it's a requirement. It's a requirement. We can't function without it, without destroying ourselves and without destroying people around us. So what do I use and what would I suggest? Is all it takes is just take a deep breath. When you're in the middle of stress or there's something going on, just, and that's it.
Yeah, a little bit too quiet. I was falling asleep. That's interesting that you said relax, because my wife is in a profession with Mary Kay, and the whole week she says go, 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 whether she had locally or somewhere else. So I took the weekend and I told her to do the three R's. I said relax, relate, and release. I said that way your body would be ready for when you start up again in a few days. She took that literally. She slept, and she slept, and she slept. That's how I know a body was stressed, and she relaxed in that mode. COVID did an interesting thing. COVID allowed women to be more aware, not of themselves, but of individuals. So the things that was not aware of in the workplace prior to COVID, they became more aware of after COVID. What I mean by aware of? Some of the interaction, the communication, of some of the words that were saying, of some of the things that were saying, or some of the things that was done by the man species in the workplace, they overlooked it. They overlooked it either for promotional reasons, overlooked it because they didn't want to be bothered, or they overlooked it for various reasons, as I said. But after COVID, when they came back to the workplace, especially the housewives that had to deal with the kids and the husband and the household, they was more aware of what was going on. So because of that, they were able to recognize that in that workplace, it was more toxic than they thought. It was more sexist than they thought. So what does a toxic and sexist workplace look like that can lead to a woman to having mental issues? It is a culture of toxic masculinity, which is a hostile work environment that undermines women. The work environment is characterized by hyper-competition, heavy workloads, long hours, assertiveness, and extreme risk-taking. This type of culture is also bad for men, but women notice this. What do you suggest women do to prevent mental health issues in this particular environment?
Yeah, leave. You know, I like what you said. If they came back from COVID and then noticed it. And that kind of goes back to the last discussion we had about stress, is taking that deep breath and what your wife did over the weekend is she took a break. Because it's easy to be in it so much that we ignore red flags. We ignore what's happening. We get so swept up in things that we just start to react. And when we're reacting, we're just kind of functioning. We're in survival mode. And so when we take a step back, that's when you get to reassess things. That's when you get to see things. That's when you get to start to think, because you're not in high beta survival anymore, running, fight or flight anymore. You're back in your reasoning mind and looking at this something around about this doesn't make sense.
So you can consider that, or you can view that as being a reality state.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It's taking a step back to reassess reality and to look at, okay, what's really going on? Because again, it's easy to be swept up in things, right? And doing and reacting. So we allow things to continue because we get used to it. But when we take a step back, it's no longer normal. And then we're like, wait, I spent a weekend, I spent a month, I spent 6 months without abuse, and now I came to it, and now it's obvious that there's abuse. There's toxicity. There's the stuff happening. And so and I'm very sensitive about calling it toxic masculinity. I think toxicity is toxicity. I think there's toxic women and toxic men. And I believe we all need to put a stop to toxicity because it doesn't allow anyone to flourish. And it really does keep a business from growing. I mean, their bottom line's going to be affected negatively by toxicity. So we should all put a stop to it. And I think women could absolutely put a stop to it. And it's not by being a victim, but it's about being voicing their concern, stopping things as they are, paying attention to the red flags, what are those, things that are coming up, and then addressing it in, as they come up. Or if it's something that is recurring, taking it to a supervisor. And if it's just an all-around toxic environment, we do have the option of leaving. I don't believe anyone needs to punish themselves by staying in an environment. And so knowing when to walk away just for your own peace of mind and well-being is, I think, the most important thing. And I'll share a story with you. And I wasn't going to share this, but it's really coming up right now. My mother worked in a very toxic environment. And she had an epilepsy that would come on whenever she was really stressed, but pretty much under control. She would feel it on coming on. She would take medication, and she had a really cruel boss who was just mean and very discriminatory towards my mom because she was different than her favorites. And so my mom wasn't feeling well, and she was trying to leave, get my son to pick her up. I mean, get her son to pick her up. And she ended up having a seizure. And with a seizure, you have your seizure, you come out of it, and she was throwing up. And so people wanted to call 911, but the boss had a rule that said you have to go through her to call 911 because it's money for the organization. There was actually a man who had a heart attack, and they didn't call 911 until they, like, she had to call 911. That's how horrible it was, literally, if risking people's lives. So she comes in to my mom, and from what witnesses said, she walks in and says, "Now what's wrong with you?" After she had a seizure, she ended up having another seizure right in front of her. This woman shut the door while she let my mom have a seizure alone in a room. They kind of ushered her out into the copy room. So she was kind of outside of the population, and closed the door until they stopped hearing the knocking, when she's bouncing around. And then opened the door and waited until she turned blue before they called 911. My mom didn't make it. She was brain dead within a week. And so when we look at toxicity, there's no room for it. It literally can kill you. It killed my mother. And I remember her crying to me, saying, "Oh, three more years until retirement, 3 more years until I can leave, finally." And I would just say, "Leave now. Like, your life, I didn't think your life, but I just said, why are you there? Just leave." And so we have to look at it in that way. It's nobody's life is worth it, so we need to address it. We need to take care of ourselves. Unfortunately, my mom had other issues. Her husband passed away 10 years prior, so she had lost her sense of mental strength and resilience, and didn't have the strength to walk away, which is why I really feel we need to develop our own capacity and capabilities and sense of self-worth so that I'm not worried about retirement or I'm not worried about losing a paycheck. I know I can go get another job because I have it within me. I can work hard. I can make things happen. And so so those things don't keep you in an abusive environment. When you look at, let's just, you know, look at a couple, right? Why does a woman stay with a man who's beating her up? Because she doesn't have any other options. She doesn't have, or she doesn't feel like she has choices.
Well, right, she doesn't feel like it, right?
Yeah. If she, you know, she feel, or he's probably trained her, you'll never get anything better.
Yes.
This is what you deserve. But if she knew she can have better, she knew she could, you know, get a degree, take care of herself, you know, have choices, then she wouldn't have to stay in that environment. So I really do believe it's up to us to notice those red flags, address them, set boundaries, communicate, find your support system. Look at what you can control, you know, prioritize yourself so you could take a step back and say, oh, no, this doesn't work for me. Not that you have to fight, and also not that you have to play victim, but it's like, no, this doesn't work for me. And ultimately knowing when to leave.
But all that goes back to what you said about clear mind, because individual stays in situations like that because they have a cluttered mind. So much is going on there. The mind is not clear. And one of the things that mentor and coach someone involving that when I was pastoring, one of the reasons why this individual said that they stayed in the situation and that they were in as far as work, it wasn't that they felt they couldn't go out and get another job. They felt that they couldn't get the quality of the job that it had. And that quality of the job was bringing a certain type of income in so that he can maintain his family, because he didn't want his family to come through the same channels that he did. So that goes back to what you said, though. If he had a clear mind, then he would have went out and searched for that job that was similar to the one that he had.
Absolutely.
So yes, it makes a lot of sense.
And I'll add one thing, you know, part of that clear mind is knowing that number one, I do deserve it, that I have a sense of self-worth, that I can find something better. And I have the ability to build up my skills or my, you know, I have positive work ethic. I can learn something new so that I can get something better. So it's not that you're, you know, you're sitting around saying, oh, I'll just get something better. It's like, no. I know I can work hard and focus and be committed to something that I can create better for myself.
I consider myself, and I don't know if other people or you look at this matter, I consider myself to understand that there are self-medicated medication that I can use to help me open my mind up and to have better understanding to make better decisions. It might be weightlifting, might be jogging. These are things that I do. Listen to jazz music, talk to myself. As long as I don't answer myself, I get a lot of stuff out by talking to myself, yelling and everything else. I close the door. Wife let me go by myself. And those I call medicated reasons to let it out and to clear my mind. And then when I come out, it's like I have a release, and it opened things up for me to make better decisions in the workplace. So I'm stuck on that open mind thing, which is good. The next thing that's in this generation, Generation Z and Generation X, is facing in the workplace is gender inequality. That could lead to a woman having mental health issues. 67% of women believe that women are paid less than male colleagues for an equal amount of pay. That's a high percentage, almost 67%. Wow. 82% of women agree or are unsure that reporting gender bias or discrimination issues at work will level to negative ramifications on job security or career advancement. Feel that the job is threatened, so they don't say anything. 82% said that's a strong number. 69% of women agree or are unsure about management choosing a male colleague for promotion over a woman solely because of gender. That's the workplace environment that leads that woman to believe that. So if things is geared towards the man in that environment, you're talking 69% of women That means they see something in the environment that men doesn't see, or that's pretty obvious. Only 60% of women strongly believe they are paid fairly and that gender bias does not impact their compensation. I expect that number to be higher than that. It might be individuals are not speaking on that topic. 80% of women agree or are unsure about men having less respect for women managers than they do for men in management positions. I'm going to leave that one alone. Gender inequity has a profound effect on mental health worldwide. Some of the psychological effects of gender inequity include higher levels of stress, anxiety, depression, and post-traumatic stress syndrome, PTSD, in women and people of marginalized genders. Gender inequity manifests itself in many different ways. What do you suggest women to do to prevent mental health issues in this work environment?
You know, I think we covered on some really great tools. And I would say, you know, one of the things that I notice as I work with women and also men, because I do coach men, is that men are more willing to advocate for themselves and talk about themselves and push their accomplishments in everyone's, I don't want to say everyone's face because that sounds condescending, but to be able to
that's the truth though.
Exhibit, you know, they voice their accomplishments. They're like, hey, I just got a $1 million client, or hey, I just did this, or hey, I just did that. Whereas women are more
subtle.
I don't say shy or meek or subtle about their accomplishments. They're waiting for someone to notice them. Mm-hmm. Waiting for someone to acknowledge them. They're waiting for someone to, you know, to give them the raise because they've done such a great job. Whereas a man will just walk in and say, hey, I need a raise or I'm out of here. Women aren't as forward in that respect. Women aren't going, you know, men will say, I did this, I did that. So they're placing a spotlight on them. Women tend to shy away from spotlights.
But what caused women to be in that position? To shy away from spotlight, because in the past, women to go in and state the accomplishment and a man to shut them down.
Well, I think it's just because maybe it's just not the way they did it. Mm-hmm. And they're not used to it. Mm-hmm. And so why do women do that? It's just not in our nature. I think the feminine energy is very much about supporting and nurturing and taking care of people. Whereas a man is out there making things happen and being loud. And so I think it's in our nature. And so we have to kind of stretch a little bit and balance ourselves with the other side. You know, we talked last time about my book, you know, The Modern Woman, Discovering Your Inner Sweet, Sexy, Badass Queen.
Go over that book again, because it's been a while since we talked.
Yeah. So the book is called The Modern Woman, Discover Your Inner Sweet, Sexy, Badass Queen.
So you have no problem saying that word now. You had struggled with it last time.
Did I? I wasn't sure if I could say it online or on the podcast.
Well, you're not hesitating now.
You gave me permission. Thank you. We women ask for permission, men are more of asking forgiveness. So there are certain things that are innate to us. And with the book, I do help women balance that masculine and feminine energy. The feminine energy is very much about, like I said, nurturing, taking care of people, making sure everyone's happy, the relationships, prioritizing others' needs before their own. And, you know, that's that mothering type of energy. And then what's also beautiful about the woman with her femininity is she brings that spiritual nature to her life and to people around her, making sure that her business is run through high values. She's always doing the right thing. People, you know, have a moral compass around her. She is honest. She is, you know, not out to take advantage or cheat people. And she's, again, out for the collective. Now, those are the two feminine energies. The two masculine energies are, one is that sexy, playmate, fun, vivacious, social, interactive part of her. And I'll tell you, it's masculine because it's focused outward. What men are good at is networking. And that's why men, you know, get those jobs and those promotions. I had a man tell me, a woman tell me, she was an architect in a masculine and male oriented field. And she's like, well, I don't want to have to hang out with the boys. I don't want to go golfing and go to a bar. And I said, why not? That's where the deals are made. Why not? That's where the relationships are happening. Why not? That's how you're going to get promoted. So there's a game we play, and the masculine energy, because they're so social, that playmate, right? The sexy, it's attractive. So when men know how to network, they go to sports games. They, you know, I mean, think about big corporations. They have a spending account where they wine and dine their clients. And men are great at that networking. And that's what's required to, you know, to build the network and the resources and place yourself in a situation strategically. And the other masculine energy is the badass. That's the CEO. That's the woman that sets boundaries. You know, I tell women, don't go into a workplace and be a man. It's not going to work. You're a woman and you have some incredible gifts that no man can match. So bring your gifts, bring your gold, bring all that nurturing, high morals, the ability to multitask and see the big picture. Women can see the big picture and pay attention to detail, whereas men are very hyper-focused. So that's a gift that helps a company grow. And if you look at the companies, organizations that are thriving now, it's thriving because there's a female CEO.
Yes.
Or a female on the high level, you know, C-suite. And so the badass CEO is the woman that comes in and says, no, this is not okay. This is, you know, you're crossing a boundary. You're being inappropriate right now. You're, you know, and so being willing to step into that in her power and hold her own. And also being willing to, you know, not play victim, but say, oh, I probably have to work a little hard. I have to, not a little hard, but I have to show up and show out my stuff, what I'm accomplishing in order to compete in this space. You know, I used to teach special ed years ago. And these kids were, you know, and my kids would thrive in my classroom. And one of the things that I would always press on them is, you know, I'm sorry, you have a disability. All that means is you might have to work twice as hard, 10 times as hard, 50 times as hard as everybody else. It doesn't mean you can't do it. And so I would push them to look at, okay, they can still do whatever they want. They may just have to work a little harder. Obviously, there's some physical limitations and other things like that, but we have to look at, okay, if I'm new in this industry, I'm going to have to work twice as hard because nobody knows me, or nobody has seen me, or nobody has, you know, X, Y, Z. And so
book states how this woman can make herself more visible and not invisible, more proactive and not inactive.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's not fighting the system. It's playing within the system. That's very strategic. It's being willing to show and showcase her work and not doing it in a whiny, you know, you need to see me way. But if people aren't listening to her in the boardroom, then connect with people one-on-one, you know, and so figure out that strategy where she could show herself, be present, network with those people that do support her and leverage those relationships, build her confidence enough to be able to, number one, excel in her work and to get herself noticed, document what you're accomplishing, you know, go for those awards, go for those, you know, those, you know, the opportunity, any opportunity to showcase your stuff. And again, set boundaries. And it's not about fighting, but it's about saying, you know, that's not okay. You know, someone starts raising their voice. Excuse me, I can hear you fine. Will you please lower your voice? Now fighting, I can raise my voice and fight with them, or I can be that feminine woman and lower my voice and bring that tension down. Say, it's okay. I can hear you. You don't need to yell. So I mean, that's powerful.
How much of an impact would these strategies have on mental health?
180 degrees.
Mm.
Is that right? 180?
Yeah, that's it.
One end of the spectrum to the other. I was going to say 360, but that brings you right back to
where
you
started. Yes, right back.
180. Because not only does it empower you, but you get results. And if it's truly toxic, meaning you're just working for a certified jerk, you know, or a narcissist, you need to leave. I mean, I used to, you know, I used to date a narcissist and I thought I would change him until I realized.
How are you going to change a narcissist?
Yeah.
How long did that take?
Yeah, I know, till I figured it out. I wasn't that smart back then. But that's when you need to know when to leave. And there are narcissists in the workforce, and yes, there are too many incredible places to work with people that support the growth of the group. And they know if they support the diversity, if they support women, they see the value of that feminine energy. They see the value of diversity, because the most successful companies have a diverse population. You can't get any new information without diversity.
Yes, that's true.
You can't have innovation without new ideas and differences. And women bring in a whole perspective that men can't have. And men bring a whole new perspective that women can't have. We need each other to thrive.
Now, more seriously, what's happening today in the workforce with women that's having an impact with them and mental health, I feel is unfair. It's not happening within my, what I'm overseeing, the warehouse of distribution that I'm overseeing. It's ageism. Mm-hmm. Despite legal protection, age discrimination at work is frequent and has significant effects on women's mental health over the life course. Financial strains partially mitigates this relationship, pointing to financial implications or perceived age discrimination for women and their family. Although federal legislation has prohibited workplace discrimination on the basis of age for over 40 years, there was a Secretary of Labor in 1967 law that was passed, the problem has not disappeared. More than 60% of Americans, 64%, report discrimination on the job. Age discrimination. Compared to race or sex-based discrimination, largely based on described demographic traits, age is a universal human experience and may therefore represent the only basis of discrimination generalizable to all workers. Please explain your viewpoint on ageism and how should women approach this environment issue.
I think if you have the age and the wisdom, you should go start something new.
You and just leave and start something new.
Yes, go out and blaze a trail. You know, I don't think that's a new concept. And I remember growing up hearing that from men saying that, oh, they're too old. Nobody's hiring them because, you know, they're too old to get hired. And so I could see that, you know, happening with women as well.
See, but it never happened to women before. Because you see women in their late 40s, early 50s. In leadership position. But now some of them getting pushed out and they taking the women in their 30s and 40s. And I have not been able to put my thumb on it yet on why it's having such an impact now in 2023 and 2024. What caused this to happen? Is it because the looks, because the quality of work? I don't know, but it's happening and it's about to get big in the workforce.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know that I'm well-versed or even experienced in seeing that because I'm not seeing a whole lot of that. I remember I was in tears one time because I couldn't figure out how to edit a video. And my son was like, Mom, it's easy. It's 1, 2, 3, and that's it. And I was like, you don't understand. I don't understand this stuff. So I imagine as we get older, we're not as on top of things that are required to soar in certain fields. And had I wanted to be in technology or in certain corporate spaces, I probably would have had to stay with the times. And so hiring someone, you know, younger to do things would make more sense than bringing someone like me in. But as far as ageism, I don't see that happening as a blanket statement. We're not going to hire you because we see your age. I think it's more, I from my perspective, it might be more of a skill and more of, am I set in my ways at my age versus someone new? You know, I've heard people say, I would rather have someone with drive and no experience than someone who's had experience that I have to retrain. So it's more of a function of what's required in the workforce. That being said, I think, you know, women with a breadth of experience, has so much ability to, again, see the big picture, pay attention to the detail, where we can start our own venture. We have so many ideas and we have so much wisdom and experience starting our own business or creating something new. And then we hire the young folk. I mean, my assistant's young because she can figure out anything. Whereas at my age, I'm not. It doesn't mean I can't. It just means I haven't. So I don't know that I have a good answer for that. I think sometimes it's knowing what you want and then building those skills that are needed for the workforce. And I think if you do that, someone would be crazy not to hire you. And I've had a number of people around me who've been in their older years who have had lots of promotions and recognition in their workforce, and they're not getting pushed out. So it hasn't been my experience. So unfortunately, I can't truly address that.
There are several myths that's out there. I'm going to cover a couple.
Okay.
Or a few. A couple few. First myth is women are becoming less ambitious. I'm going to let you respond.
This could be further from the truth. You know, the women that I work with are more ambitious than ever. And if anything, you know, the recent years, the pandemic has fueled their ambition because they've seen more choices. They have access to more choices because of the flexible work arrangements. They allow them to achieve a better work-life balance, to be able to take care of the things that are important to them, their family, their children, and express themselves in something new. So they have more mental space, more energy to pursue their career goals. They can be, again, present for their family and still be strategically advancing in their fields and in their career. So I believe women are more ambitious. There's more women starting businesses right now. And I think that's because women have had more options. We're not stuck at home, forced to stay in one role of being the caregiver. We have opportunities to express ourselves.
Next myth, good answer. The biggest barrier to women's advancement is the glass ceiling, so-called the broken rung. And it's the greatest obstacle women face on the path to senior leadership. What's your reality?
You know, I see the glass ceiling and broken rung as two different things. The glass ceiling is where we can't grow to the high level executive positions. And I think women are, or companies are seeing that women in those top executive positions do remarkably well. I think where women are maybe getting held up is in those low, kind of those first few steps positions. And part of it is because they haven't figured out the game. And by the game, you know, like what we talked about before, it's the networking, it's strategically placing yourself in front of those decision makers, letting them know that, you know, hey, this is what I do, notice me, you know. So I think getting those first few steps is probably more challenging than, you know, once you're at the top, unless there's, you know, clear toxicity. I think the first few steps are probably the most difficult, because it's an unlearning and it's a new learning of ways we as women interact. But I believe once you learn it, you can soar.
Yes.
You can absolutely soar.
Microaggressions have a micro impact. Your reality.
Oh, yeah. Microaggressions. No, it's those small things that build up. It's the little jabs. That can be significant, and it adds up over time, and it really starts to eat at your soul and your motivation and your desire to work. So I think microaggressions can really take a toll on women and men, on all of us, and negatively impact our ability to create what we want. And I think that's where we as women need to draw attention to them immediately. It's like, you know, if you let one thing slide, you're going to let all of them slide. So it's calling people, which is difficult for women, but calling people on what they're doing that's not okay. And not in a mean way, but in a powerful and gentle way. And then have consequences. Meaning, if we let people continue to mistreat us, and all we do is we whine or we tell them not to, and we let them get away with it, then We've pretty much taught them that they can get away with it versus, you know, please don't raise your voice or I'm going to leave this office. And then as soon as they raise their voice, just walk out of the office. And so it's being willing to act. When we're loud in our actions, we can be quiet in our voice. And I think that's where the feminine power is.
But what method to prevent mental health also prevents stress and aggravation will you use? Because this also is a form of everyday discrimination that is often rooted in bias. They signal disrespect, cause acute stress, and can negatively impact women's careers and health. So sometimes just the bias alone causes you to be overly aggressive. So what method do you suggest that they use to keep open mind?
When someone's being overly aggressive, again, draw attention to it. Set your boundaries. Be willing to act on it. Being willing to follow through with whatever is appropriate. And again, if it gets to a point where it's just abusive, nobody deserves any kind of abuse. It's never okay. And I think we need to lower our tolerance for it, and not, you know, again, cry like a baby or whine or be a victim. But it's oh, I'm sorry, that was insulting. Were you trying to insult me? I mean, I'm not getting mad. I'm not yelling. I'm like, oh, it sounded like you were calling me a name. Is that, you know? And so calling people and being willing to stand up for yourself. Now it takes level of confidence.
Right.
Level self-worth to do that. And that's where your personal responsibility comes in, is I need to build myself and I need to constantly build myself. And if I get mistreated one day, I need to go home and reassess how I'm allowing this and maybe regain my strength. No, wait a second. He mistreated me. I didn't do anything about it. I feel crappy. What would I love to do? And replay it in your mind. I mean, part of mental health strategy is replaying situations and asking yourself, what would I do if this were to happen again? Because I promise you it'll happen again until you stop it.
Right.
So when you're prepared, which is part of building your own mental health resilience, then when it comes up again, you can act differently. Not react the same way, but act differently. And when you act differently, you get a different response.
Last myth, it's mostly women who want and benefit from flexible work hours. Your reality.
Oh no, men and women love the flexibility that COVID gave us. And I think it's great for mental health, and assuming we all take personal responsibility and we're completing our work. Because it allows both men and women the flexibility, the ability to create a more well-rounded life, which allows us to be more productive and more engaged and innovative in our work. So I think both men and women both love and are benefiting from the flexibility. I'm a big proponent in that. I'm a big proponent in flexibility and being able to work from home, hybrid, be able to pick up your kids and then come back to work. I mean, all of that. I think we're meant to work to live, not live to work.
Wow. Well, thank you, Trez, for coming on to my podcast. As usual, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed the conversation. I enjoyed the laughter. What do you want to say to my guests going out?
Oh, it's been my absolute pleasure to be here and to talk with you about this thing, about these things, these topics that are truly important. And I'd love, you know, anyone who is looking to excel in their life or their career and would like to look into coaching to reach out to me. I have the blessing to be probably the only Trez Ibrahim in the world. So if they Google me, they will find my book. Which is on Amazon, and my social media links, be able to connect with me and see how we could possibly work together. And I have a ton of free content online. So please learn, grow, and also know that nothing can ever limit you except you.
Thank you. Take the time, go research her, find out about her. She gave you the okay to call her. She gave you okay to communicate with her via email or whatever communication, social communication method she has for you to communicate with her when you research online. I encourage you to do so. I'm asking that my followers subscribe to me. If you're looking at it on YouTube, subscribe. If you're looking at it on Spotify, subscribe. If you're looking at me in your dreams, subscribe. Just subscribe to me. Thank you. I appreciate you. Until we meet again, God bless you and goodbye.